How you doing today, folks? I'm Thomas, and today I want to talk about choosing the perfect deer rifle and cartridge. And the reason I'm going over both is because over the last few years, I've really started thinking of them as just interconnected parts of a system. And I think when you start thinking about them as part of a system, it makes things a lot easier when you're deciding what you need and, you know, coming up with something that works and works well. So pull up a chair. This is one of them old cold rainy days right now, and it just seemed like the perfect time to talk about this. And Christmas is just a few days off, and you know, I know some of y'all might be looking for a new rifle and cartridge, or some of you might have just had some problems last year with your rifle and cartridge. And hopefully I touch on some things that, you know, help you out a little bit. Because this, you know, no matter what gun you got, you can make it work in most situations. But anyway, let's get into this. The first rifle I want to talk about is the old Winchester Model 94. Okay, and, you know, just about everybody knows what this is. The old Marlin lever actions, they fall in the same category as this one. Basically, they're what I call short-range rifles. And for me, there's three classifications of rifles. There's short-range, intermediate, and long-range. All right, well, if you look at this as a system, this is about as simple as it gets. Okay, and we don't even think of this as a system because we don't really need to. I mean, everything's been refined on this over the years, and basically all you have to do is get a rifle. You can get one brand new off the shelf, get a box of 30-30 cartridges, go to the range and set your sights, and you're good. All right. And there's something for all y'all to keep in mind, and a lot of y'all wonder, why would anybody ever use this? You know, as the distance increases that you want to shoot, the system gets more complex, more expensive, and less dependable. All right, and what I mean by that, all right, again, as simple as it gets. All right, so there's not much to go wrong here. There's no scope to worry about bumping. There's, you know, you don't have to worry about what twist rate in the barrel. You don't even have to worry about what barrel length. You can get these in longer barrels, but why would you? And this is where thinking about it as a system really comes in. Okay, let's say you got a longer barrel on this so that you got a higher velocity out of the 30-30 round that it shoots to increase your range. Well, have you really accomplished anything doing that? Because you still got iron sights on here. All right, so you're still limited to under 100 yards because of your sights. And then this, with this tubular magazine, you still have to use, you know, flat base or flat tip bullets. Okay, so you're still not going to get the performance of a pointed bullet or Spitzer. So there's really no need to change any part of this system to increase range, because every part of this system works together to make this a perfect short-range rifle under 100 yards. Now, you could change all the parts of this to increase your range, but then you got a new rifle. And for most people, most areas, This works. All right, so, you know, don't ever think poorly of the old 30-30. They will get the job done. Okay, you can put a scope on them. The Marlin's a little easier to put a scope on than the Winchesters, but hey, you can do it on the Winchesters. But, you know, you still got limited range. No matter what you do to this rifle, this is a short range rifle. All right, but that's the advantage. It's a simple system. Not much to go wrong. You know. All right. Then we got, well, let's go ahead and talk about long range for a second, because that's the opposite extreme. Long range, to me, that's over 300 yards. Okay, that could be, you know, 800 yards, 500 yards. The standard for what's long range shooting now has changed a lot from what it used to be. Well, now you got to have a precision scope. You got to have a scope that you can adjust the turrets to change, you know, where you're going to hit to compensate for all the distances. You need a laser rangefinder. Okay, well, they're battery operated. That's something else to go wrong. Aren't you need a You need a bipod or a bag that you're going to shoot off of, and you're going to shoot off that bag all the time. And whatever you use for a rest on your long-range rifle is going to become part of that system. That laser rangefinder is part of that system. That high-end scope, you really do need a good scope for that. That's part of that system. Your ammunition. Whereas this one, you just go get a box of cartridges and whatever grain off the shelf, you're good. Okay, well, that long-range rifle, you're going to shoot a very specific cartridge in it, and you're going to put a lot of work into finding what cartridge that gun likes, and you're going to put a lot of time into shooting it. You're going to put a lot of time into working with that system, and that system's going to be complex, and there's any number of things that go wrong. Your Kestrel that you're going to hold up to check your wind speed, because wind speed's important. It's another electronic device, batteries to die, you know, it's a more complex system. This, like I said, you're just going to get a box of cartridges, set your sights at the range, you're hunting. Okay, they don't get no simpler than that. And that's why so many people have loved these rifles, you know, for so many decades. All right, now what most of us use, I'm going to call a medium range. Okay, and here's another old classic. A lot of you Brits out there, people from Commonwealth countries, you'll recognize this one. This old Lee Enfield, number 4, Mark 1. In 303 British. All right, and despite this being a really old rifle, this is what most of us are using now. Okay, most deer hunters were using intermediate range rifles, and that's good from, you know, point blank to whatever the maximum point blank range of your cartridge is. Okay, and that's something I really want to touch on here, because a lot of people don't really understand that term. But what that means is you can put your crosshairs on a deer, pull the trigger, and hit the deer in vitals at whatever distance before your bullet drops too low to hit vitals. Okay, and that's how most of us hunt. We, with our rifles, we're putting the crosshairs on the deer. We're shooting the deer. Right. At whatever your maximum point blank range is, that's where your bullet, at that point, your bullet drops too low to hit whatever size target. Past that distance, you've got to raise the rifle up and shoot over the deer to make the bullet come in and hit the deer, because you get too much drop. Well, there's calculators online that you can punch in the numbers for your cartridge, the velocity and ballistic coefficient of the bullet, and it'll tell you what your maximum point blank range is. All right. And what you do for that is it'll tell you how high to set your sights at 100 yards. All right, so you're shooting high at 100. You're coming back down close to level at 200. Then you're dropping down a little bit at, you know, past 200. Or actually, you're dropping down pretty quick past 200. And most rifles today fall between 250 and 300 yards. Almost every standard cartridge today, from 243 to, you know, 30-06, is somewhere in that 250 to 300 yard range for your maximum point blank range. The faster your bullet's going, the flatter your trajectory is going to be, the further your point blank range. But, you know, 300 is about max. And that's your 270, 130 grain, you're looking at 300. Sub mag, if you drop down to 140 grain bullets and you get the velocity really up, you're looking around 300. And some of your really fast ones, you're, you know, a little over 300, but it's not a lot. Okay, I'm not going to focus a whole lot on the short range rifles for this video. Right, if you're hunting really thick stuff, and that's how you hunt, what you hunt, you know, for where you live, and you never have a shot over 50 or 60 yards, you know, 70s, your max, it's a great rifle. It's bottom line. But most of us are hunting in a variety of situations. One day you're in the woods, next day you're in a, you know, clear cut, the next day you're hunting, you know, field or whatever. Well, most of us have gone to this because it's a little more versatile than the short range rifles. Okay, with this, you know, I'm good from 0 to 240 yards with a particular bullet I'm shooting. That's a lot of range there I can cover. All right, but there's some trade-offs. Okay, this is not as simple as this old Model 94 right here. Okay, I've got a free-floated barrel that I, you know, it's got to be free-floated because I got to get the accuracy down pretty tight on this gun to be shooting those kind of distances. I got a scope on here. All right, that's something else to go wrong. I got rings and base on here. Again, that's something else to go wrong. Screws to come loose. Scope to bump or break. All right, so this isn't as complex as a long range rifle, but it's more complex and it's more expensive, and I'm going to have to spend more time with this than a short range. Alright, and the short range being so much easier to shoot, I don't feel like I need to put a lot of time into that. Okay, but with this, I really want to hit on a few things here, since this is where most of us run into problems and need some more information. So with this rifle here, let's break this down in what I was saying earlier about thinking about this as a system. All right, the cartridge, 303 British. It works exceptionally well with this rifle. All right, this rifle was developed for military use, and for those of y'all that aren't familiar with the very extensive history of this rifle, the cartridge works perfect for this rifle. All right, they're interconnected and they work extremely well together. All right, the scope. This rifle was not made for a scope. They made some changes to where you could mount a scope on it. Some of these were used as sniper rifles in World War II, but they made other modifications that most of the sporterized versions like this don't have. Okay, and by sporterized, someone at some point, don't you know, for y'all purists, don't worry, it wasn't me. The wood's been removed off the barrel. It had wood handguards all the way out. It had a cover, protectors for the front iron sight, a nice peep sight at the rear. Well, this one doesn't have it no more because it's a scope base here. All right. The magazine, that's part of this system. And the action, that's part of this system also. The trigger is part of this system. Okay, for most of us, this type setup works. Whether it's a brand new whatever rifle off the shelf, it's, you know, you're going to put a scope on it to give you that extra range, and you're going to pick a cartridge in between 243 and 30-06 more than likely. It's just my personal belief. You hunt whatever you got confidence in, but I just don't see a need for a Magnum caliber for deer. I mean, you know, it's each into their own. Just for intermediate range hunting, I see no point in a Magnum. Again, that's just me. Long range, that's a whole different ball game. Okay, and I'm not going to get into the long range stuff because that is such a complicated thing. I mean, that's its own several, you know, 10-part video series on long range hunting. And I mean long range. And that's just not something I'm into because I don't need to be into that with where I live. I'm not going to have those kind of shots. All right. But with where I live, this has been a really great deer rifle over the years. Okay. Now, in talking about this system, I'm going to look at some things a little differently than most of y'all look at things now. And this is one of the reasons I wanted to do this video. Okay, I'm not here to tell you how great this rifle is, but I'm going to. I'll get into that shortly, but there's a lot of bad information out there now. All right, and misinformation maybe would be a better term. Well, that's the stuff I want you to really understand from this video and use when you pick out a rifle and cartridge. All right, because there's a lot of rifles and cartridges out there that work great, but some are going to work better than others. And I'm going to go through some of the factors and show you how those factors work on this rifle. Okay, and part of what inspired this, a friend of mine that I work with, I ran into a few days ago before we got a few days off for Christmas, and he was having some problems. And he was having trouble hitting deer. He was having trouble, you know, even after he hit them, had some bullet performance issues. And that's a frustrating place to be. And a lot of us have been there. A lot of us have had problems with, you know, different cartridges and rifles, and be it accuracy issues or bullet performance issues or whatever. We just had trouble, you know, we didn't have trouble getting on the deer. We had trouble putting the deer down. Okay, right, you know, with no drama and no issues. Well, to me, that's what choosing a good rifle and cartridge is all about. You got a rifle and cartridge, it's going to get the job done. Right, it's something you can depend on. Okay. Well, I started thinking about, you know, all the things that are popular now and features. And if I were to come up with a checklist of everything that's being advertised now, and most of it's to help you improve your accuracy, and that's the most important part, is putting the bullet where you want it. Matter of fact, there's only two things that can go wrong. Either your bullet isn't doing what it's supposed to do, in other words, it isn't expanding right, and all that's, you know, involved with the bullet itself, picking the right bullet for your cartridge. And I did a whole video, as long and drawn out as it is, I did a whole video covering all that. The other thing is, you're not putting the bullet where you need to put it. Shot placement. If your bullet does what it's supposed to and you're putting the bullet in the right spot, there's no issues. You get a deer every time you pull the trigger. Okay, well, if I put together a checklist of all the features that they say you need now, you know, like, you know, less than one MOA accuracy and, you know, a really great trigger and on and on and on. This rifle would score dead last on that checklist. Okay. But it's just, there's one problem with that. This rifle's really good at killing deer. Now, I know a lot of y'all are going to say, hey, that, you know, a lot of rifles out there that kill deer. And you're right, there are. But this rifle's really, 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 really good at killing deer. I mentioned it's really good at it. All right. My daddy gave me this rifle when I was 16. He'd used it, you know, before then, and he killed deer and never had an issue with it, ever. And I had a couple different rifles that had various issues, and, you know, so I know what it's like to have bad experiences. And I'd never killed a deer. I'd shot a couple deer and couldn't find them, including some big ones. All right, opening day when I was 16, a deer walked out at 150 yards and I put the scope on him with this rifle, pulled the trigger, he hit the ground. And I just went on a killing spree after that with this rifle. Okay, I don't even know how many deer I've killed with this rifle. I mean, it's a bunch. I've killed more deer with this rifle than most people have seen in their life. Okay. And I've killed them from 10 yards to 300 yards with this rifle. And I've never missed a deer. And I've never even come close to losing a deer that I shot with this rifle. Okay, so when I say this rifle's really good at killing deer, I mean it's really good at it. Well, to have a rifle this good at killing deer, and like I say, if we went by modern standards on what you need, and this rifle comes in dead last, something's wrong. Okay. So I'm going to go through, you know, some of the things we think's important now, and it's advertised on guns now, and it's pushed on guns now. And I'm going to talk about them as they relate to this rifle and how it all works together as a system. Okay. And the first thing I'm going to talk about is accuracy. That's a big thing now. You know, rifles that are guaranteed one MOA or less. My dog's wanting to play. Okay, rifles advertised as one MOA or less out of the box. Well, here's the big thing on accuracy that most of us just don't understand now. It took me years to understand this myself. You can have two rifles and one's one MOA or less out of the box. The next one's two MOA out of the box. All right, so the one that's one MOA or less is more accurate. But that doesn't mean you can shoot it more accurately. Okay, and that's what's so great about this old war horse right here. Okay, at the end of the day, that's why it is such an outstanding rifle. It's because I can shoot it extremely accurately in the field. All right. And keep in mind, now when we're in the field hunting, we don't have bipods and we're not shooting off benches. Okay, we're propping up on the side of stands and, you know, we're side of a tree, or we're standing, kneeling. And it's rare that we shoot out of the prone position in the field. It's hard to find a place you can shoot out of prone position. You know, you got grass in the way and bushes and different things. So just because a rifle's extremely accurate doesn't mean it can be shot extremely accurately. And like I said, the two things that can go wrong, and the second one being related to the system itself, shot placement, you've been able to put the bullet where it needs to go. Your whole goal and what you're looking for in a rifle and a cartridge is to get something that you can shoot accurately. And if you can shoot it accurately and you put the bullet where you need it, then at the end of the day, nothing else really matters. I mean, so that's what you're looking for, something you can shoot accurately. So what's advertised on it out of the box really ain't that big of a deal. Almost every gun nowadays, you can shoot it more than accurately enough, or it has enough inherent accuracy built into the rifle that you're going to be, you know, no problems out to whatever the maximum point blank range is for your cartridge. Okay, so don't worry too much about what it says on the MOA. And if your gun's less than one MOA, hey, you got, that's bragging rights. That's all that is. Okay, and to put that in perspective, I had an old friend of mine, good hunting buddy, who passed away years ago. He hated this rifle. I mean, he absolutely hated this thing. He talked bad about it. He couldn't stand to look at it. Said it's the ugliest thing ever. All right. Where was I before that battery died in the camera? Oh yeah. Come up, old friend of mine, Russell. He hated this rifle. I mean, he absolutely hated this rifle. He said it's the ugliest thing he'd ever seen. Russell and myself and another friend, Joey, we went out one day after deer season and we set up some targets, 300 yards. And Russell had a really nice high-end rifle, 7 Mag, nice scope on it. And my friend Joey had the same rifle and 7 Mag also, same scope. And Joey also brought us 243. Okay, and I brought Old Faithful here. It was the only rifle I had for many years. We were probably in our 20s then. And matter of fact, I'm going to tell you the brand. It don't matter because it's a great brand. It's a Browning A-Mac. It's a Browning A-Bolt too. Excellent rifle. Accurate rifle. That's what Joey had as well, and Joey also had a Bolt 243. Russell fired 3 shots at target at 300 yards. He barely hit paper on one side with one shot. He barely hit paper at the bottom with another shot and missed with his 3rd shot. Joey, he had very similar experience with 243 and a 7 Mag. I fired 3 shots with this old war horse right here, and I had a group about like this at 300 yards. I never let them live that down either. My old wore out war horse rifle, putting them to shame. Their guns were more accurate than mine. No doubt about it. I mean, they had those Browning's A-Bolt 2s, they're accurate rifles. The difference was I could shoot mine more accurately than they could shoot theirs. Okay, so don't worry about what guaranteed accuracy your rifle has. What matters is how accurately you can shoot it in the field. Okay, the next thing that's big now is the trigger. Alright. I'm going to dry fire this one because a lot of you younger guys now, you know, the only thing some of y'all have ever experienced is the modern triggers that, you know, adjustable and real light pressure, and you barely squeeze it and the gun goes off. All right, we're clear here. All right, watch my finger and when this gun goes off. See all that movement? All right, this has what you call a two-stage trigger. That's what most of your military rifles have, and a lot of your older hunting rifles. Okay, and I'm going to get a lot of flack on this one. A lot of y'all going to say I lost my mind. Y'all going to disagree with me. In the field hunting, a two-stage trigger is better than a single-stage modern trigger. All right, now let me clarify that, because I know a lot of y'all shaking y'all's heads right now. If you're in a rock-solid position, prone, on the bench, you know, bipod, the new triggers are more accurate. Right, you can shoot those. The trigger has nothing to do with the accuracy. All right, let's throw that out there right now. The trigger's irrelevant. Okay, what affects the accuracy is you. Okay, so if you're in a rock solid position, you can shoot a rifle more accurately with the modern single-stage triggers. All right, so if you're shooting extreme long range, that's what you want, single-stage trigger. Okay, well, when we're hunting, we're not in a rock-solid position most of the time. Very rarely. You know, like I said before, we're in a stand. We're propped up on a rail, maybe, or, you know, we're up against a tree, or we're, you know, or for closer range shots, we're not propped on anything, you know, we're just shooting. Okay, when all those positions, you've got movement, your rifle's bobbing when you're trying to put it on the target. And I'm exaggerating this just to show what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about here, though. When you're not on a rock solid position, you got that little bit of weave in there, that bob. With a two-stage trigger, after you practice with it, you can time it so that it goes off right as the rifle gets on target. Okay, that's a lot harder to do with a single-stage trigger. And that's one of the reasons I outshot my buddies that day. Okay, they had, you know, really nice triggers, but we weren't on very stable, you know, setups. Matter of fact, we were shooting across the hood of a truck. Hey, you know, young, just let's see what happens. Okay, no, most of you don't have a choice now. Most of you, newer rifles, and the newer rifles, nothing wrong with them. I'm not knocking. But what you need to take away from that is if you've got that single stage trigger like almost all the new rifles have, you need to do everything you can to make sure you have a very stable setup for when you do shoot. All right, so when you're in your tree stand, make sure your tree stand's got a rail that you can set up on. Okay, I've got a tree stand now that I hate that tree stand, but there's the rail, it has a rail, but you can't prop up on it. Okay, so that rail, as far as a rest, it's almost useless. So shooting long distances out of that tree stand, it really isn't an option unless I get some kind of rest that I can put the rifle on for that, you know, for that steadiness you need at longer distances. And that's going back to the whole system thing, okay? If you're going to shoot long distances or longer distances, you know, 200 yards, that type of stuff, if you're going to reach out to whatever the maximum point blank range is on your cartridge, you need a way to stabilize your rifle, and whatever that way is part of the system. So you need to think about that part of your system. Do you have a prop for your tree stand? Or, you know, if you're on the ground, do you have a, you know, a bipod that you can, shooting sticks that you can use? All right, so once you get into, you know, a really stable position, those single stage triggers are great. And I figured all that out years ago. I'm showing my age, but we actually had a rifle team when I was in high school, and I shot competitively. And I was fortunate enough to get to try both triggers, double stage and single stage. Well, my scores from the prone position were always higher with the single stage trigger. Not a lot, but it's, you know, consistently, day in, day out, it's higher with the single stage. But my scores in all the other positions and my total score was always higher with the double stage trigger. I just, like I said, when you get into the sitting and standing and kneeling, and you got that little bit of bob, you know, a little bit of movement, you can shoot that more accurately with the two stage trigger, because you can time that trigger going off just perfectly with it when it goes over the target. It's easier to time it than a single stage. All right, so again, don't worry if you got a new one. Just work on building, put more work into building a solid setup. And that's going to help you no matter what on shot placement and putting the bullet where it needs to go. Because that's, a lot of people just don't realize how hard it is to hit a small target at even 100 yards. It's, you know, amazing we do what we do. But anyway, that's something to keep in mind. Okay. Next thing, you know, popular these days is flat shooting cartridge. All right, this old cartridge here, when I was talking about that checklist, you know, all the features you need now that everybody's, you know, being pushed by marketing and so forth. This cartridge here would almost be considered underpowered. And it's slow by today's standards, but it's slightly behind the 308, just to give you an idea of, you know, what we got here. It's a little bit behind the 308 Winchester. All right, I got a 180 grain bullet in it. My maximum point blank range with this 180 grain bullet is 240 yards. Okay, well, that's, you know, pretty decent. All right, if I drop down to 150 grain bullet, now my maximum point blank range goes up to 260 yards. Okay, because I just increased my velocity because I got a lighter bullet, higher muzzle velocity. Alright, 270 Winchester is one of the flattest shooting rifles there is. With a 130 grain bullet and a 270 Winchester, your maximum point blank range is right around 300 yards. Alright, if you go up to 150 grain bullet and a 270 Winchester, which is what most of you need to be shooting because it's a more consistent bullet than the 130 grain. And I explained all those reasons in my video on cartridges. Alright, if you go up to 150 grain bullet and a 270, now your maximum point blank range is 270 yards, 272. All right, so by point blank, you know, going by maximum point blank range, which is what most of us use. Okay, most of us aren't adjusting our turrets, and we're not using laser range finders. You know, we're putting the crosshair on the deer and pulling the trigger. At 270 Winchester, despite the extra recoil and powder and everything else, you're only picking up 12 yards on your maximum point blank range. Right, so, is this cartridge really underpowered? Okay, and keep in mind this is 311 thousandths inch diameter, so I guess you'd call it a 30 caliber, even though it's slightly larger than the American standard for a 30 caliber, but. Alright, so you got a pretty, you know, good sized bullet here. What does more damage when it hits? the bigger the diameter, the more actual tissue damage you're going to do on a deer when you hit it. The more tissue damage you do, the greater your chances of not having any problems finding your deer. All right, and shot placement's always critical. I don't care what you're using. But on a small diameter cartridge, like 243, it becomes even more critical. Well, that's, and 243 is a wonderful cartridge. Alright, and there's a lot of really good reasons from, you know, a lot of people to shoot a 243. If you're recoil sensitive, even if you ain't recoil sensitive, less recoil is just generally more accurate. You're more comfortable shooting it. And I don't care if you can handle the hardest hitting cartridge there is, you're going to enjoy shooting a lighter recoil cartridge more. Alright, so, you know, this underpowered cartridge is only 12 yards behind a 270 of the same grain bullet. I wouldn't call this underpowered. Okay, and the 308, it's right in there in between the two. Alright, so we're all, you know, right around that same maximum point blank range. You know, so the underpowered thing, don't worry about that. The, you know, flat shooting, don't worry about that. It's, you know, all of them are right around that same range. Unless you start really dropping down in bullet weights. Like I say, the 270, 130 grain, you're up to 300 yards now. There ain't many cartridges out there that you're going to be over 300 yards on your maximum point blank range. And that's including your 7 mags and such. I mean, you really have to pump that velocity up to get past 300 yards for maximum point blank range. Now, if you're going to be adjusting your scope turrets and laser range finder and checking wind and all that stuff, then that's a whole different ball game. Okay, and then you pick a cartridge based on that, and that's, like I said, that's a whole different game then. But for an intermediate range cartridge, you don't have to worry about being underpowered. Okay, this old 303 is not underpowered, 7mm 08 is not underpowered, 308 is not underpowered. Matter of fact, the guys in Canada, I'm sure a lot of y'all have heard many stories about killing everything that walks with this old 303. You know, moose, bear, whatever. I mean, big game. A lot of you guys have probably done it. Okay, this old slow 303 works. All right, so if this works, you know all your short action cartridges out there are going to work. And 7mm 08, 308, 243. You know, don't worry about being underpowered. Don't buy a long action 30-06 or 270 because you're afraid the short action ain't going to get it done on an intermediate range rifle. All right, now if you're out west and it's really flat ground and you really feel like you need that extra range, okay, then think about that then on long action. Okay, and for me personally, I do have a 270 that I set up just for long range. But as I mentioned in the video talking about bullets, I put a lot more work into that rifle to set it up for that, and it's not my go-to rifle. Okay, this one isn't my go-to rifle anymore just because I've retired it. A war horse is showing its age, and I'll do some future videos on that. You know, but I'm getting long-winded enough now as it is, so I'm not going to get into all that. But, all right, next factor, weight. I see so many lightweight guns now, you know, alpine rifles, mountain rifles, featherweight. There are times and places that it's worth it to have a light rifle. If you're hiking however many thousand feet up there in the Rockies, okay, I really get wanting to save weight. But here's the thing, it's easier to shoot a heavier rifle more accurately than a light rifle. And there's a lot of reasons for that. A heavy rifle, you got less recoil. That's one of the factors that controls felt recoil is the weight of the rifle. Okay, and this is where the whole system thing comes in too. If you get a lightweight rifle, you need to get it in a light recoiling cartridge. Okay, so I wouldn't suggest anybody go get a featherweight in a 30-06. Now, if you shot one and you liked it, and you've got a lot of experience shooting rifles and so forth, and hey, if you liked it, go for it. I mean, I love the Winchester featherweight rifles. I've got one myself in 257 Roberts and used it a lot in the woods this year. But it's not as accurate as a heavy rifle. Let me back up on that. The rifle itself is just as accurate as any rifle, especially with today's technology. But you can shoot a heavy rifle more accurately. All right. Light rifle, it's affected by so many external forces. You know, the wind's blowing, your heart beating, your breathing. Okay, a heavier rifle's not as affected by those external forces. So it's easier to hold it on target. Heavy rifle, you get less recoil. Alright, so when you do get the recoil, instead of it coming back and jumping all over the place, straight back, and that's generally it. And, you know, unless you got a heavy recoil, and even in a heavy rifle, but you still get some jump, but you get less. Alright, and I'm here to tell you that affects accuracy. I don't care what anybody says about the bullets left the barrel before the recoil. I'm calling, you know, just straight up BS on that one. And we can do a whole video on that if y'all want to later. All right, so, and if we look in the past at rifle weights, all right, I think about the most famous hunting rifle ever is Winchester Model 70, you know, pre-64s. That's the rifleman's rifle. Well, those, from what I've seen, generally came in right around 8 pounds. And from what I felt picking them up, that they felt like 8-pound rifles. They're solid. Okay, you're browning bars, the sporting version, not the, you know, military issue. You know, they're generally a little over 8 pounds. And those, you know, there's so many really good stories out there about Browning bars being people's go-to rifles and them always getting the job done. Same for the Model 70. This rifle here, it's heavy, but guess what it weighs? 8 pounds. Okay, right now with the scope on it, it's a little over 9, but you add you always figure in about 1 pound for your scopes and rings and stuff. Maybe more if you get a really big scope. Okay, so if you go with a light rifle, you need to get it in a light recoiling cartridge. And you really need to make sure you got some experience shooting so that you know what you're picking there. You're aware of what you're doing. And you need to be confident you can figure out how to shoot that rifle accurately because of that extra movement on the recoil and, you know, it just being tougher to get steady on a deer or target or whatever. All right, so when you see a rifle advertised as lightweight, for 90% of us out there, that's not a positive. Okay, that's just what they came up with to justify using plastic in the rifle. All right, they turned, you know, replacing steel with plastic into, oh, it's weight saving. All right, yeah, you can call it what you want, but to me, it's not a plus unless you really know what you're doing there. All right, so anything around that 8-pound mark, that's going to be, you know, from a recoil standpoint, a good shooting rifle. Okay, the next thing, compact. Okay, and that maneuverable goes with that, and usually what that means is short barrel. Okay, this is one of those individual things. You know, we each have to figure out for ourselves. Me personally, I hate a short barrel. I mean, it works on this old Winchester Model 94. It's a carbine, 20-inch barrel, and it's for close distances. All right, so this short barrel is perfect. There's no need in having a longer barrel on this. And it handles great, and it balances great, and, you know, it's perfect for this. All right, for intermediate range, we're looking at about 25 inches on this barrel, okay, as opposed to the standard 22. Well, 22 has become the standard. 24 used to be. All right, to me, a rifle with a longer barrel balances better. Okay, think of an arrow, how well it balances, how much feel you have with, you know, you're aware of where it's leaning and at and so forth. Versus a short rifle just feels like you're carrying a brick. There's no balance there, it's just weight. Okay, like I say, for me, I prefer the long barrel, and in my case, this cartridge here is on the weaker side compared to modern cartridges. And this, hey, they came out with this one to use black powder originally because they didn't have smokeless powder then. That's how old this is. All right, this longer barrel helps me get every bit of velocity I can out of the cartridge. Okay. Plus weight to the rifle, keeping it right around that 8-pound mark, which is where I think most intermediate range rifles need to be. Again, that's just opinion, you know. All this is just my opinion, but I'm just throwing some things out there that I believe firmly in. Okay, so if you're wanting to really stretch your bullet out there, you know, and you're going to go with a long action, you live out west somewhere or something, and you fit your standard hunting, you need a, you know, a 270 or 30-06, get a 24-inch barrel. I mean, just, I don't care what the guy at the store says, you know, 22's just as good, blah, blah, blah. No, it ain't. I mean, it's just, you know, if you're going with a, if you're trying to shoot, get all the distance you can, because, you know, you're out west shooting long distances, then go ahead and get the 24-inch barrel and get all the velocity you can out of the cartridge. All right? And, you know, me, I'm in the southeast. It's thick here. I've never had trouble, you know, by my barrel being too long. You know, I deal with a goose gun on a turkey one time, but that's a whole different story. All right, so not many rifles today, they don't offer many with a 24-inch barrel, even any long actions, but there's some out there, and if you look around, you can get them. 22 still works. All right, you're not losing a lot of velocity, but nanny magnums, that's a whole different issue. Okay, and it's back to the whole system thing and thinking about it all as a system. I saw a lever action in 300 Magnum for sale the other day, and it had a really short barrel on it. There's no point in that. Okay, because you do lose velocity quick with the Magnum when you start, you know, shortening that barrel. I know 270 and 30-06, they're pretty good about not losing a lot of velocity. I think the average is like 30 feet per second per inch as you get shorter. So 24 to 22, you're not losing a whole lot. All right, but you're still losing some. And my thing is, why do it if you're already looking for speed? But if you're going from a 300 Magnum or sub mag or something like that to a shorter barrel, you're losing speed quick. All right, and that's why most of those come with 26-inch barrels. And if you really feel like you need that kind of velocity, that you need to go to a Magnum caliber or cartridge, excuse me. If you need that kind of velocity to get a 26-inch barrel, because otherwise you might as well just get a 270 or 280 or 30-06 to start with, because you're going to lose so much velocity that you're going to be shooting the same velocity as a 270 or 30-06 or 280. The last thing I just want to touch on is looks of the rifle. Okay, and I get that. When you're going to pay a lot of money for a new rifle, darn it, you want it to look good. All right, but this is about killing deer. And it's about getting a gun that you can shoot accurately. Don't worry about the looks part. And hey, there's enough good looking guns out there now, you still got plenty of choices. All right, and this has nothing to do with the picking the rifle, but for me personally, I think it's important to get a rifle made in the USA. We got the most lenient gun laws in the world. Okay. And a lot of countries that a lot of their guns are coming from now, they don't have very lenient gun laws. Why would you buy a rifle from a country that doesn't let its own citizens own the rifle that you're making, or that you're buying, and that they're making? Okay, and I think it's important to keep the gun industry doing well here in the U.S. too. And that doesn't mean there's anything wrong with their rifle. Okay, some of the best rifles in the world are made overseas. This one was made in Canada, even though Canada's really strict on their gun laws. But of course, this was made a long time ago and for different reasons. But this is a long branch. But that's just one of my personal things. And what you do, that's, you know, think about it, and you know, whatever your conscience tells you. All right, folks, I covered a lot of information here, and I know I did. I know it's long-winded, but hopefully it's interesting and helpful. You know, even if you had to watch all this just to get two or three good pieces of information, I'm working on presenting this stuff better, but it's almost any topic worth discussing is complicated. That's why I named the channel what it is. And talking about choosing a rifle and cartridge, that's complicated. I mean, we got so many different, you know, levels of experience out there. And levels of experience and two completely different things. Hunting and rifles are two completely separate things. All right, you can ask someone who is just an absolute expert, super skilled hunter, phenomenal deer hunter. He's never fired a firearm in their life. You know, maybe they hunt with a bow. Okay, you can have somebody that's super knowledgeable about firearms that's never hunted before. All right, and then you got somebody who's new to both, and then you got people that are really knowledgeable in both. So it's all right, just approaching this topic is tough. And I know I made it about as confusing as it probably could have, but it's a complicated topic. But anyway, I hope y'all at least got something out of this. And you know, if I missed something or could have covered something better, please leave your comments below. And for the channel, I'm working on, you know, improving what I'm doing here. It's a learning process for me. And I'm getting more comfortable in front of the camera now. I still got a long ways to go, and I know I'm boring and monotone. Hey, I know it, but I'm working on it. And as far as this deer season, I had a few videos on deer hunting. Well, we had some family problems in the last couple weeks, and you know, I hadn't been able to get back to the woods. But I'm hoping to get at least one or two more trips in and, you know, get a little deeper into that. And then first of the year, I'm going to hit the ground running with a lot of different material. So that's the plan for the channel right now. And, hey, I'm open for comments and suggestions. Just, you know, put your comments at the bottom. And, hey, like and subscribe if you got anything useful out of this. And y'all have a Merry Christmas.